depends on, as long as you know the limitation, you know how to use it, how not to overinterpret it, and how to make the best of it. So I want you to be aware. So the typical things are that traditionally, this is when I was as young as you guys are now, the photon sources were some extra characteristic emissions were used. Most common was the aluminium K-alpha line, which has this 1.5 kilo-electron volt energy. Magnesium K-alpha also was used extensively. Some people used also, this would be zirconium, sorry, not gamma, but ZR, M zeta line, silver, yttrium, many things were used. But these are the two standard. In the low energy, people used UV lights, helium-1 resonance, helium-2 resonance. Some people also used argon, neon, etc., but these are the two most common used. The reason for using the two different ones, I already said, this will only look at the valence band because it doesn't have enough photon energy. If you're interested in the core level, you also have to use the X-rays. But then you could think that why don't we just stay with the X-ray because that will give me valence band, which I get from here, and also the core level. But it so turns out that this has much higher resolution. Because remember, the energy conservation that I wrote down is uncertain with respect to the uncertainty in the photon energy, right? Because I said H2 minus kinetic energy is equal to binding energy. I want to find out the binding energy. So if my H nu is not certain or my determination of K is not certain, that uncertainty will be the error on my binding energy estimate. So the resolution is directly controlled by the resolution of the photon energy H nu, that ideally I said let us start with a monoenergetic photon. But you have never a monoenergetic. There's always a distribution of energy that you're getting. And that way, here it turns out to be in the order of 1 mV or smaller, and here it is in the order of 1 eV. So there's a 3 orders of magnitude difference in the resolution. And that's the reason why one prefers to do this when one wants to understand the valence band only with high resolution. But if you also want to look at the whole level, you go there but lose the resolution. But when the photon energies are about this range, you can see that the kinetic energy, of course, is going to be limited by the photon energy, remember? We talked about it. And so the kinetic energy of electron that you are interested in measuring is in the order of 10 electron volt to 1.5 kilo electron volt. Mean free path, as I said, is going to be less than 20 angstrom, which means that material is extremely, extremely, extremely surface sensitive. And then this statement comes in that we need ultra-high vacuum condition and in-situ surface treatment. What do I say that? See, if it is that surface sensitive, that means I am going to look at the first layer of the material. And suppose I want to study as simple a thing as copper. Okay. I have the copper, and I am going to shine light on it and see copper. Will I see copper? This copper is constantly being bombarded by the oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, moisture. It will oxidize, right? It will oxidize very, very quickly. Do you have any idea how quickly it can oxidize? Actually, there's a unit of adsorption. So what I'm asking, suppose every atom that collides with it, every atom of oxygen that collides with the copper surface will stick and form a bond. This is an approximation. But it's not a very long approximation. It may be wrong by at the most a factor of 10, an order of magnitude. So let us imagine that every oxygen that bombards will stick to the copper atom. How long do you think it would take to cover the copper surface with one layer of oxide? I want students to make estimates. 1 year, 1 month, 1 week, 1 day, 1 hour, 1 second. You have order of magnitude estimates. So this drop, what do you vote for? Go on, say something. You will be wrong whatever you say. So it doesn't matter. Everybody is going to be wrong. What is your guess?
1 minute. 1 minute?
Okay, this block is represented by 1 minute. This block. Quick! I don't have so much time. I'm asking you about time. Picosecond mein chala gaya, 1 minute to picosecond.
Second.
It takes in the order of, see, there is a unit called language. It's named after a famous scientist, which corresponds to, one language corresponds to forming one layer. With this sticking coefficient that I said is one. One language is measured by a 1 second exposure in a pressure condition which is 10 to the power minus 6 torr. Okay. How much is atmosphere? In the order of 10 to the power 3 torr, 760, but 10 to the power 3 torr. So 10 to the power minus 6 torr is 10 to the power minus 9 atmosphere. So at 10 to the power minus 9 atmosphere, it takes 1 second. So at 1 atmosphere, it takes 10 to the power minus 9 second to cover 1 layer. So you have a nanosecond time in which one monolayer will form. So even if you cleaned your sample surface, you have about 1 nanosecond to complete your experiment if you are trying to do it at 1 atmosphere. At 10 to the power minus 9 torr, since it, at 10 to the power minus 6 torr, it takes 1 second. At 10 to the power minus 9 torr, you have 10 to the power 3 seconds to do the experiment, which is about 15 minutes. Which is not good enough. At 10 to the power minus 10, it gives you 150 minutes. You can get some signal nicely. But after that, so first of all, you have to get to about 10 to the power minus 10 torr vacuum. And after 150 minutes, what do? You again have to clean it. You cannot clean it out in the atmosphere because you clean it, you have to transfer it in less than in that picosecond time for it not to be contaminated. So you have to do the cleaning inside. So you need a surface cleaning treatment in situ, inside the ultra vacuum chamber, and the ultra vacuum chamber must be in the order of 10 to the power minus 10 torr. Necessary. Otherwise, you're going to look only at the dirt. And this is something that you have to ask every time you want to do an electron spectroscopy measurement of your sample. Whether you're looking at your sample or you're looking at your sample plus the dirt that is deposited on top of it. This is something that is not often appreciated. And people get very upset when I ask this question. They say, what do you mean dirt? My sample has no dirt. Okay? So then.
Is there any desorption at very high
It depends on the strength of the adsorption. When we talk about sticking coefficient, we talk about the situation which will not desorb. So anything that you call chemisorption will not get desorbed. Most of the physisorption also have sufficient energy at room temperature to stay stuck. Because what you are talking about essentially the binding energy and the temperature scale comparison. And it's slow. You can then do, of course, you're dynamic pumping, but even a physisorption has enough energy associated with it compared to the room temperature, no. But on the other hand, if you have, for example, a layer of water and you put it in, you know that it dissolves even an atmospheric condition. So it really depends on the interaction strength. Now, these laboratory sources, one has moved to synchrotron sources, and there you have from down to a few electron volt all the way up to, actually synchrotron can give you up to 100 kilo electron volts. But photo emission people have pushed up to about 10 kilo electron volt, 15 kilo electron volt. There's some technical difficulties of going beyond.
Is it because of the spectrometer or is it not needed actually?
No, not needed.
No.
Not also the spectrometer. Both can be overcome. Main problem is the cross sections are becoming so rapidly. You know the exponential decay of the cross section. So the signal becomes so weak that you will spend forever trying to look for it. That is the main impediment.
But even with a very high source speed?
Very high source, you can get very good resolution. But the number of photons are going down, and your cross section is exponentially decaying. And so the intensity becomes a main problem. That photo emission process becomes very weak. When photon energy is so high, the absorption of the photon energy by the electron is going down. Photons are passing through the material without being absorbed. So now that we know what the basic considerations of electron spectroscopy is, we can now build the spectrometer. It's a very simple thing. Because you have all the knowledge that you need to have to build an electron spectrometer. So this is the this word already introduced, Gedanken. Or was it Saurabh? Saurabh, yeah. So we are going to, because these theory types, they're all the doing time doing Gedanken. So I wanted to tell them we also can do Gedanken. They think they are the only one who can think, because Gedanken comes from thinking. Okay? Thought experiment. Right. So we are going to build up a spectrometer just by taking it. So what do I need? Something that will produce photons, because spectroscopy, I need a source, photon, so fine. I'll find that photon source, which can be characteristic X-ray emission. So I take an anode, bombard it with high energy electron, where I apply, putting a filament, heating it up, it will give out electron. I put a very positive voltage on the anode, it will bombard, I'll coat it with aluminium, it will give out aluminium to alpha. Good, that's trivial. But I need the sample to be held in the path of the photon. Otherwise, I'm putting photon data and sample is here, and it's inside the high vacuum chamber, I can do nothing, I can only watch like this. No photoelectron. So I must be able to manipulate the sample inside and put it in the right place to optimize signal. So I need a manipulator, obviously. But I need, electrons are going to come out. Once I've put it in the path of the photon, and photon has enough energy, electrons are coming out. Now I have to measure the number of electrons coming out and their kinetic energy. So I need a detector. Electron analyzer, I'm saying, analyzer, it will analyze the kinetic energy and tell me at that kinetic energy how many electrons are there. So the total detector, you will have two units. One is measuring the kinetic energy, and the other is telling you how many electrons are coming out with that kinetic energy. Something that will count the number of photons is definitely wrong. I think that should be the electrons. You know, I've been giving this talk for so long, and I discovered the mistake now. And it's only because you guys, the young ones, have been very unkind to me. You think it's kindness not to point out the mistake of the teacher? And so now I know that 20 generations of students are laughing at me that DD has a mistake that we didn't tell him about. If you'll be kind, you'll point out my mistake so that I can correct it. The remaining 5 generations will at least not laugh at me. Right? See, often what you think is kindness is being unkind. You don't correct the mistake of your near and dear ones, you're doing a terrible mistake and being very unkind to them. Remember this. I always say that a friend is one who criticizes you on your face and defends in your absence. There's a time reversal symmetry with what an enemy is.
Is there
a question on that? Sorry, look, otherwise everybody is looking so glum, I have to have laughs. Okay. There is a need to count photon, but here...
The initial intensity
we need to know. Basically, remember, the intensity is, I said proportional to the density of state, but it is also proportional to the number of photons that you are giving. So if the photon is changing with time to time, then the intensity that you are getting is completely stupid. So most of the time we do the experiment in such a way that the photon intensity remains constant. If it didn't remain constant, I had to measure the photons and divide by the number of photons to relate it to the density of states. But I'm sure that is not what I have in mind here. Okay? And this detector is detecting the number of electrons. And then I've already talked about it's a very surface sensitive technique. So I need to clean the surface after putting it into the UHV chamber. And so I need some kind of devices. I need an iron gun maybe, which will sputter away. I may put a deposition unit so that I freshly deposit the metal very clean. I can heat up the sample to make desorption happen and so that the contaminant can go away because temperature is what I'm going to use. Or I can have a scraper, mechanically scrape away an exposure bulk bond. You have to do all these things, and you have to think always in terms of these when you think of doing photoelectron spectroscopy of your sound. And we must, after doing all that, you must have some technique to figure out that the surface is clean, and that the spectroscopy you are going to do will tell us. But there are sometimes other techniques you put in, for example, low energy electron diffraction to see the surface geometric structure, etc. And the surface will again get dirty unless I have a very good vacuum chamber and pumping system that will keep pumping it out dynamically and keep giving me very good high vacuum. So these are the components that I have ordered, right? Now, depending on how good your purchase section is, these are blank. I can see a sympathetic smile, really. This joke, all over the world, gets a giggle out. Let me tell you. You're not the only one suffering in the world. Everywhere it's the same. There is always procedure and processes that every scientist thinks is completely unnecessary, right? And I'll not get into that debate. But now that all the components have come, let us put it together. Before putting it together, because now we are ready to construct our first spectrum tank, what we'll do is to figure out how to measure the energy of the electron. Right? Other things we have talked in some detail. How do we measure the energy of the electron? It's actually a trivial process. Think of, you have a parallel plate capacitor, okay? And I make a well-defined slit, a small slit, an opening. Through it, I'm going to shoot electrons. And I'm going to put another slit, and you see that this slit are not aligned. Why is it not aligned? Because after all, if I apply potential, then you can see that's a negative potential, that's a positive potential, and when the electron comes in, it will come in through that slit, but it will get pushed towards the positive and pushed away from the negative. Correct? Now, give a well-defined potential difference, how much the electron will deflect depends on its kinetic energy. So if I measure the deflection, I am measuring the kinetic energy. And if I measure the deflection as a fixed deflection, that is the staggering of this hole with respect to this one, then the deflection has been fixed, then only one specific kinetic energy will come out through that. So it's acting as a kinetic energy filter, and I know what kinetic energy is coming out. And that kinetic energy is proportional to the voltage that I've applied. So I can use this filter to scan through the kinetic energy by scanning this voltage. Because I put another voltage, another kinetic energy comes through. So then, if I put an electron collector here, I'll know how many electrons are coming out with that particular kinetic energy. So I've analyzed the kinetic energy using this, and that collector here tells me by the current that is coming out, how many electrons are there with that kinetic energy. This is exactly what we do. It's a parallel plate capacitor, but the parallel plate capacitor is not in the horizontal geometry. For some technical reason, you make it hemispherical. Hemispherical analyzer, where you have two pieces, you see that's one surface and that's the other surface. It's a distorted view of the drawing, they're perfect hemisphere. The gap, the annular part, is the empty space in between. You apply positive voltage here, negative voltage here, electrons get in from here. And this hemispherical structure gives a focus. Space focusing on the same kinetic energy entering at different angles in a three-dimensional and angular aperture, it defocuses itself so that I don't lose any of the electrons with that same kinetic energy. So that's a technical aspect. And then I put something here which is going to count the number of electrons coming out with that kinetic energy. The sample is here, the photon source I put, photon impinges on the sample, when the sample manipulator places it in the right place. Electrons come out, but these electrons come out here, and this bulky object is at a very great distance. So I want to translate as a 1:1, all the electrons that are coming out over there, and so we put an electron lens system that essentially images this spot on the sample onto a spot, a small hole over there. And then the electron is analyzed, and I can have all surface cleaning, and I have the pumping system that I have talked about. Typical resolutions, I have already said, aluminium K-alpha, magnesium K-alpha, characteristic emission lines in the order of 1 electron volt. Monochromatized aluminium K-alpha, you can get it down to about 0.2 electron volts resolution. Helium 1, helium resonance ones, you can get it down to sub-milli electron volt. Today I have written on 1 milli electron volt. So you can get all these kind of resolutions. Okay. Now is that? Brain. You need the brain. So now I'll begin to, not complicate, but complete the story and when you come back. Okay? There are nice, interesting twists. There were a lot of people asking me questions. And then I realized that answers to those questions and those questions themselves would be interesting to many others in the audience. So I refused to answer any question during the tea break. And I requested them to ask the questions now. So before I get started, shoot. Yes, go ahead.
Sir, this tag bond method, you apply for...
What method?
Tag bond.
Tag binding.
Tag binding application method. You are applying for inorganic coordination metal oxide. So there is other silicon compound with conducting poly. Those are also conducting to hobby metal. So is it equally applicable for this?
Since you are asking a specific question, I will give a specific answer. In conducting polymers, the tag binding method would work very well. Except for the fact, when you are talking about polymer, remember the periodic structure that you have assumed is highly dubious. So it's not a crystalline material. So that brings in a complication, not the tag binding part. So if you do a tight binding calculation in real space where you don't assume what the periodicity is, but write down each position separately and then try to do the calculation, then it still is a tight binding approach. And it will be fairly good, depending on how large the calculation is. So there are some complications that one has to be aware of. But tight binding approximation per se will not be a problem. You have a question.
Electrons is coming out from the material when you exert the photon. There is electron deficiency in that material.
That's a very good question, and many of you should have thought of it.
Can you repeat?
That, I'm going to repeat the question now. That the photoelectron spectroscopy is an essential process in which an electron is going out of the material. And I have to measure actually literally millions of electrons before I get the signal. So I'm pulling out millions and billions of electrons from the material. So the material should get charged. And if it is getting charged, then there's a problem because that means the material is changing continuously its state. Every time I say the material is in n particle state, but that is not true. Once I pulled out the electron, next time the energy conservation, the I will have to start with n minus 1 and it will become n minus 2. Next step it will be n minus 2 and then it will be n minus 3. How do I avoid that? What is happening? First of all, think that I'm talking about a metal. And this metal is actually connected through that sample manipulator to the ground. The implication of that is that ground is an infinite reservoir of charge. So every electron that I pull out, one electron from the ground moves in. Through very complex series of processes, because the electron will move in at this level, because that's where the unoccupied level are, right? In the metal. But the hole may be down there. But that hole gets filled up through X-ray emission or OG electron processes, which takes high electrons, drop them down, the energy difference goes out as a photon or gets another electron ejected, and this process cascades up till all the holes are pushed up to the Fermi energy, and at Fermi energy, electrons are being pumped in from the Earth to neutralize it. That's for a metal. If you are talking about an insulator, then you have a serious problem. And this is a problem that electron spectroscopists constantly are struggling with. The sample is getting charged. To a fair accuracy, in many of the cases, it can be seen as a constant potential being built because of these electrons that you're pulling out at random are, because they're random, they're uniformly distributed. So they present a potential barrier for the electrons that's coming out so that this energy equation gets modified by that barrier. So all your signals get shifted and we call it the charging shift. what limits this charging shift, because normally it should go on shifting more and more because I'm going on pulling out more and more electrons. But what happens when I pull out enough number of electrons, there's enough band bending because the electric field shifts my valence band sufficiently to overlap with the fermion energy of the spectrometer. And then electron gets pumped in. So there's a steady state that is achieved, which determines what is the steady state potential that builds up on the insulator. And if you are lucky, it can be approximated by just a uniform potential, and then all your signals are shifted. Then you have to figure out a way of shifting it back so that you can find out what the binding energy, current binding energy is. So that's called charging effect. Very often, it's not a uniform charging, because if your density of material is varying because you didn't pack it uniformly enough, you'll have potential that is changing from place to place. And electrons are coming out from different places, they see different potentials. So one peak can become 3 peaks or 10 peaks or a very broad peak. And sometimes you see no signal, it gets so broad. So these are real practical problems that you encounter. In an insulator, one of the ways of trying to neutralize it is that you switch on a filament which is giving out electrons at low energy. And these low energy electrons are flowing down and neutralizing. There today, spectrometers available where this has been refined to a level where you can put in as high an insulator as you want, and it has its own algorithm to neutralize it perfectly, and you have no problem with it. And there's been a special request from one of